Welcome to our last Challenger Connection. I hope a lot of you have been watching those videos and you all entered into our contest, and we had over 50 questions that we had to choose from, and we chose your questions because they were very thoughtful, and we thought Colonel Wilcutt would enjoy answering those questions. So Miss Jennifer's with me. Most of you probably recognize her. If you're in our clubs or go to camps. And then, of course, our special guest is Colonel Terry Wilcutt. And we all know that Colonel Wilcutt is Kentucky's one and only astronaut. So we're hoping someday that maybe you'll be our second astronaut. Right, Terry? You wouldn't mind having a partner, would you?
That's for sure. I'd love it.
Looking forward to it. All right. Well, Terry, I know, Colonel Wilcutt, I know you've been busy getting ready for the launch on May 27th. I told these guys a little bit about that this morning, and that you are the chief of safety and mission assurance. And so you've been very busy making sure that our American astronauts will be safe on this this flight. So I'm going to turn it over to you for just whatever you want to say to everybody. And then Jennifer and I will call on the students to ask the questions. So go ahead, Terry.
Great. First, it's what a privilege and a pleasure to be here to answer your questions. And I'm looking forward to getting them. Like Melissa said, you know, this week, matter of fact, on Wednesday, I fly down to Kennedy Space Center for our final flight readiness review before SpaceX launches the first two American astronauts to launch from America since the space shuttle was retired in 2011. So it's been almost 9 years since we have been able to launch our own astronauts from our country. We've been buying seats on the Russians' spacecraft, the Soyuz, and it's done a fantastic job. The Soyuz is a great spacecraft, and we have a great partnership with our Russian aerospace friends. So anyway, after this week, then the next week, I'll fly back down to Florida. And like Melissa said, we'll be launching on the 27th. Of course, if the weather's not good or we discover a problem, we'll slip the launch, but hopefully it'll go off on time. It'll be on TV. So if you want to see it, and again, it's been 9 years since we launched something from America, a human that is, then I encourage you to turn on your TV and watch it. It should be exciting. I also want to encourage you to sometime go down to Kennedy Space Center and watch a launch yourself. It's really spectacular. While you're there, you know, you can have a day at the beach or go to Disney World as soon as this virus thing is over with. But I would encourage you to check the launch schedule, plan a trip, and go down to Kennedy Space Center and watch one of these launches. It's just spectacular. And with that, I'm ready to answer any questions that you have. Who's first?
We've got Nathan Franklin. He's a sixth grader from Paducah Middle.
My name is Nathan Franklin. I'm a sixth grader going into seventh at Paducah Middle. And my question was, how did you get from flying in the Air Force as like a test pilot to becoming an astronaut for NASA?
That's a good question, and it works the same for everyone. When I was a test pilot, I got to work with brilliant engineers, sometimes scientists, and I got to fly a really, you know, a set of really exciting airplanes. At the end of my test pilot tour, I was wondering what to do next, and a friend of mine, who was also a Marine pilot, he was already in the astronaut office, and we were talking about, you know, the end of my test pilot career. And he said, Terry, why don't you think about applying to NASA to be an astronaut? And I thought, well, that was really the first time I had thought about it, because what I wanted to do was go back to a what we call a fleet squadron in the Marine Corps. But when I thought about what NASA does and what astronauts do, of course, they get to fly, in my time, a very exciting aircraft, which was the space shuttle, and you would fly higher and faster than any other aircraft or a spacecraft at the time, winged spacecraft. And you get to work with brilliant engineers and brilliant scientists. And their mission is always, it's for good. It's for the good of the planet. It's for the good of the people. And that appealed to me to have that as a mission. So this is, here's the part that would apply to everyone on here. All you do to apply to the astronaut office is go online and fill out an application. About every 2 years, we ask for applications to become astronauts. And you literally just fill out an application and send it in to NASA. It's on USA Jobs, but usually when we ask for more astronauts, it's in the papers, and you just keep an eye on it, or just check the next astronaut class. Just Google that, or when is NASA accepting more astronauts? And you simply turn in an application. Of course, you're competing against other people, and they will see which ones are qualified. To qualify as an astronaut, you have to have a master's degree in some technical field. It doesn't matter if it's math or physics, or you're a veterinarian or a meteorologist, just has to be in some technical discipline. And that's all it takes, is to get qualified. Now, we do a real good background check to make sure that, you know, that you're a team player, that you've got good grades, just things like that, you know, that there's nothing that would not make us want to select someone. But most of the people that apply have all those things. Your competition is pretty tough. Anymore, we get over 10,000 applications for like a class of 10 or 12 or 20 maybe. So it pays. If you want to be selected, then you need to have good grades. You need to be a team player and demonstrate that somehow. You need to stay away from drugs. Don't do anything criminal. Be a good person, basically somebody that people would want to work with. While you're in space, you're in a little tiny environment and there's no place to go. So you want those people to be nice folks. And then the most important thing, that was turn in that application. So do well in school, be a team player, be a good person, and then put in the application when you get your master's degree. And you can always, you know, if you think about this later and you think, what did he say? Then just get a hold of Melissa Duncan. She'll always have my email address, and I'll remind you of what it takes, and keep going, keep making those good grades. Don't get discouraged. When you get to the tough courses, just plow ahead and do the best you can. Did that answer your question, or was there a follow-up question on that?
You said to go on to the, you said it was on USA Jobs, but you can apply for the NASA online. Is that international or is that just in the US?
If you're asking, do we accept international astronauts? We don't. Every country has their own selection process similar to ours. And then, of course, when we have an opportunity to work with international astronauts, then our agencies work together and say, hey, we have room for a French astronaut or a Russian cosmonaut or a Japanese astronaut. Then they come and join us in our office, and they're assigned to have jobs and train and eventually fly in space also. So we work together actually very, very well with our international astronauts, but they all have their own agencies that do their own selecting.
Thank you.
Right. Thank you.
Nathan, great. No problem. Nice question.
Thanks, Nathan. You were in the Marines, and I read somewhere that you've flown over 40 different types of spacecraft. Is that right?
No, airplanes. But
I meant airplanes, yes.
Most of those were when I was a test pilot. I was there at a good time. So there was lots of developmental work in aircraft being done during my time as a test pilot. So I had an opportunity to fly a lot of strange airplanes and then a lot of traditional ones. It helps build your experience as a test pilot to fly all these different ones and see where they could have been made better, the past airplanes that would go for World War II airplanes, World War I airplanes, Korean War jets, and modern, you know, of course, Vietnam era modern airplanes, including huge passenger planes. So like most pilots, when I'm in the back of the airplane, a commercial jet, I keep waiting for somebody to come on the intercom and say, is there a pilot on board? And I could say, I'll be glad to go up front because they've trained me to fly commercial airplanes too.
Our next question is from Tate Jeter, and Tate goes to Calvert City Elementary, which is in Marshall County, and he is either in fifth grade or going in fifth grade. So it's Tate.
How does NASA train astronauts for zero gravity, and how do they prepare to return to Earth from a zero gravity environment?
We have an airplane. This is a little model of an F4, but imagine that this is a big passenger plane, and we take all the seats out of the back, and then we put big padded foam blankets up on the back. Well, we take our astronauts, and we go out flying, and then the pilot picks the nose up, which mashes everyone to the floor, and then when it gets to about this many degrees nose up, he pushes the stick forward. When he pushes the stick forward, he pushes it forward to make the airplane fall at the same rate as gravity, so everyone in the back is at zero G, and they float in the back. That's the only real zero G experience that we get here on Earth, but it gives you a sensation of what it's like. You're in this room, and suddenly you're floating, and it's just like being in space. Anything you touch pushes you to the other side of the room. If you spill out water, it floats in a ball, and you can put a straw in it and drink it in midair. So that's it. And of course, that only lasts a few seconds before the nose gets far enough down, and then you have to pick the nose back up, and he starts the whole thing over. So we fly through the sky in these big parabolas, and we're giving everybody about 30 seconds worth of zero gravity about 20 times before they go back. So that's how we actually train. The other thing we do is we put them in a swimming pool. We put them in the spacewalking suits, then we put them in the swimming pool, and we put weights on their suit so that their feet don't sink, and their head, so they're actually neutrally buoyant in the water. And we have them practice spacewalks that way. But that's about it. The other thing that we do, of course, is just get them used to a different environment. We fly them in high-performance jets. We have a fleet of T-38 aircraft, which are kind of sort of like this. It's a two-seat airplane, and we have them around. We fly them acrobatics and have them operate, the spacecraft. Even if they're a scientist and not a pilot, we teach them how to operate the T-38 so they can perform in an operational environment. And that's the best we can do. The only thing left is you're launched into space, and then the main engines cut off, and you're suddenly experiencing sustained zero gravity for the first time in your life. We don't have any other way to do a better job of training you than that. Now, coming back down to Earth is different after you've been up there for a while. You have, for you to maintain your balance here on Earth, your body, your eyes provide signals to your brain that tells you whether you're straight up or upside down or sideways or you're falling. You have those canals in your inner ears that tell you whether you're falling or spinning. And then you have sensors up the back of your leg from your Achilles tendon up. If they're stretching, it's because you're leaning forward. So your brain puts that all together when you're on Earth to tell you whether you have your balance. It helps you walk. When you get to space, the only thing that works is your eyes, your inner ears. There's no gravity, so they don't function. You need your legs anymore because you float everywhere. So those sensors quit working. And your eyes, if you're closing in on something, that doesn't mean you're falling. It just means you're floating toward it. So your brain gets a little confused in space, but it adapts. Usually at the end of the first day, your brain is adapted to being in space. When you come back down to Earth, and there's nothing right now, there's nothing we can do to help this. When you come back down to Earth and you land, suddenly those other sensors, they all three start working like normal. And your brain has for the time you've been in space, your brain has quit listening to them. Well, now it's being flooded with input and it has trouble making sense of it. So when you come back down from space, you usually feel really, really dizzy. And it takes just a few hours. If you've been up there for 2 weeks, it takes a few hours for you to return to normal. If you've been up there for 6 months or longer, then it takes it takes quite a while, several days for you to feel normal after that, because your brain has really learned to ignore those signals and it has to reinterpret them again. It has to decide to receive them and then reinterpret them. So most people, when they come back from space station, they need help getting around for a few days before they can function on their own. We won't let them even drive a car for quite a while because we're afraid that just driving the motion and driving a car, that they would get dizzy and maybe turn into something. So there's nothing we can do to practice coming back, but we do practice before we go up in that zero-G airplane and then in the big swimming pool we have.
Next up, we've got Annalise Clark. She's a fourth grader from Hickman County Elementary School.
How high does the space shuttle have to fly until it reaches the point of zero gravity where you would float around if you were not buckled in?
That's really an interesting question, because it's really not a question of how high. It's a question of how fast. First of all, the space shuttle goes, my lowest mission was about 110 miles in space, and that was above the Earth's atmosphere, but just barely above it. And then the missions that go to the Hubble Space Telescope or the space station go up to about 300 miles. So space shuttle and the capsules that we use now usually go up to 300 miles. But for gravity to happen, what happens is, let's see, can you see this, Annalise? Can you see this paper? Okay, let's say that you're here and you throw a baseball. Can you, is this showing up for you? What happens? Well, the baseball just, the baseball falls to the ground, right? Mm-hmm. What if you threw it even harder? Well, it goes a little further, but it still falls to the ground. Well, if you flew it at a certain speed, and let's put you on the surface of the Earth. Well, if you flew it at a certain speed, it would fall at the same rate, or a rate that matches the curvature of the Earth. It would never touch the Earth. That speed is 5 miles a second. So for you to orbit the Earth and float around continuously, then you have to be going at least 5 miles a second. And if you're doing that, then you'll fall at the same rate that matches the curvature of the Earth, and you'll float around. If you're less than that, you'll still float while you're falling, but you would wind up back on the Earth. Your spaceship would come down. That we would call that suborbital. You don't orbit the Earth, you're suborbital. You're not fast enough to make orbit. We have a big tower in one of our centers, and we pump all the air out of it. It's very, very tall. And at the top of it, we'll put experiments that we want to try this experiment in zero gravity. So we pump all the air out so we don't get any air friction. And then we drop the experiment. And of course, it automatically turns on when we drop it. While it's falling, it's doing the same thing we do in space. It's basically going through zero gravity because it's falling at the same rate that gravity pulls it. So we have a zero G chamber here. We don't put any people in it. But if you want to float around like we do in the space shuttle, then it's not really the altitude, although the shuttle goes from 110 miles to 300 miles. It's how fast you're going. If you want to stay up there and float around for weeks at a time or years at a time, really.
We are going to go on to Megan Darnell. And Megan is a fourth grader at North Elementary School.
My question is, what does it feel like in microgravity?
It feels great because, of course, you're floating. Sometimes when you're in space, you'll just start laughing suddenly, just spontaneously. And it's because you realize that you're floating just like even actually better than a bird, not just like a bird, but better. And sometimes we have between the mid-deck and the rear compartment in the shuttle, or between the shuttle and the Russian space station mirror, there'll be a big long tunnel. And we'll get at one end of that tunnel and push off. And we're betting each other that we can float all the way through that tunnel without touching the walls or the floor or the ceiling, just because you can. It's wonderful. All the aches and pains that you have, you know, you see people my age, when they get up out of a chair, they groan or grunt sometimes, or when they bend over to pick something up. Well, you don't have in space with no gravity. You have no aches or pains. They all disappear. The air is filtered, so no one has a sinus or an allergy problem. It's the best you'll ever feel in your entire life. It's wonderful. That's what it's like to float around in space. And the heaviest thing, you could take any desk here on Earth and just pick it up with your two fingers because it weighs nothing. So it's very easy to get the work done. So easy, in fact, that we have exercise machines to make sure our muscles don't atrophy and disappear while we're up there. But it's great, and it feels wonderful.
Maxon Fisher is a sixth grader from Mayfield Middle School.
My question was, how does it feel to sleep in space?
It feels wonderful. All the things I just talked about, how you have no aches or pains, it really is like sleeping on a cloud. You weigh absolutely nothing, and anything that you touch in space pushes back on you with, of course, an equal and opposite force. So you don't even really feel the pressure of a blanket, or we sleep in sleeping bags, and you Velcro your sleeping bag to the wall or the ceiling. And of course, it doesn't make any difference in space. But when you climb in there, again, none of those things, they're against you, but they're not really touching you. Whenever they touch you, of course, they're slightly pushed away. So it's like sleeping on air, and you sleep really, really well. Usually after the second day you do. Now, most people, or a lot of people, they can't go to sleep unless they feel like there's a pillow on their head or their face somewhere. So we have a big strap that it's Velcroed and it goes across your forehead, and you put a little tension on that Velcro, and it gives you the feeling that your head is against a pillow. And then the folks that have that problem, they go right to sleep after that. And the only thing that those first couple of days while you're adjusting to zero gravity, it's unusual enough. I think most people have a little bit trouble sleeping. But after that, then you sleep like a baby. The Mission Control Center, when it's time to wake up, they send an alarm up to sound in the ship, and they play music. You know, your friends, while you're in space, they give Mission Control. They know the kind of music you like, so they'll pick one of those songs, and they rotate between the crew members, and they'll play some song that you like, and that's what they use to wake you up. And they do that because everybody's probably still asleep when that alarm goes off. It's a great thing. The softest bed you can imagine.
Our next question is Sydney Lasley. And Sydney is an eighth grader at Callaway County Middle School.
Can you really see the Great Wall of China from the moon or from space?
Not really, not with a naked eye. You know, it's long enough, but it's so thin, you could never see it from space. But we do take photos out the windows all the time. And even cities look like little gray blobs against the background of the Earth. So for instance, if you know that it's in Beijing, then you can spot Beijing because we all take Earth observation classes so we can learn to recognize things from space. So you know when you're going over China, you can look at the coastline and tell where Beijing is, and it's nested up into a little mountain range there. Well, the Great Wall is just to the west of that. So you know where to point your camera. And we use cameras with telephoto lens and huge telephoto lens. And we take pictures of those. And then when we get down to Earth, again, we develop the pictures and we blow them up. And you can see in the photo where the Great Wall is. But while you're in space, you couldn't see it. We see it after the fact in our photos, but not while we're up there. That's a great question. A lot of people wonder that. We use the same thing to take pictures of like Houston. When we fly over it, we recognize the coastline in Galveston Bay. And then when I see to take my house from space, well, then I could see the gray blob through this big telephoto lens. The Ellington Airfield is just a few miles from my house. So I know that if I take a picture of Ellington Field and look, you know, let's say 5 miles away from that, then I should be taking a picture of my house. Of course, you can't see individual houses, but at least you know it's in there. It gives you a little bit of home.
Next up, we've got Emily Samuelson. She's a fifth grader from Lone Oak Intermediate School.
My name's Emily Samuelson, and my question is, when you are in space, does the ship recognize a certain time that is like day or night? And like, so, like, do you have like time zones or something like that?
That's a great question, because, you know, it takes 90 minutes to go around the Earth. And so every 45 minutes, you know, half that time, you'll get a sunrise or a sunset. Part of the reason you go to sleep at night is it gets dark, and your eyes know it's dark. They transmit a signal to your brain, and your brain releases something called melatonin to help you go to sleep. Well, in space, you go through what we call the terminator, which is the boundary between light and dark. You go through that terminator every 45 minutes. So your brain would get a little confused if it didn't adjust to this, and if we didn't have lights inside the shuttle or the spacecraft. But sure enough, to answer your question more technically, the shuttle or any spacecraft does know whether it's light or dark outside, because it's got a GPS inside of it, a version of GPS, and we program it to know when it's light or dark, because we need to position the solar rays to capture the sun. And even if you're on the night side, we position them from where they were on the day side to where they're going to find the sun when they come out of dark and back into the light. They want them to pick up the solar energy right away. So the spacecraft does know where it is always. And for the people, that night and day cycle, it confuses the chemistry in your brain a little bit. So we have bright lights inside the spacecraft to keep that. Now, when you go to sleep at night, we have, because every 45 minutes, remember, it's going to get bright again or dark, and that would wake you up for sure. So we have big shades that we put on the windows to block out all the light to allow us to sleep at night. Some people wear a sleep mask. They would like to have a window open, but so they'll just wear a sleep mask. But for the most part, and if there's anyone else in the room, then we'll put shades up to block the light on the daylight side. It's kind of interesting. I always slept on the flight deck where my seat was, where the commander's seat is. And I would block that up, but I want my folks during the daytime, you know, when you're awake in the spacecraft, you're busy. Every minute is scheduled just about. And so if you want to take some time just to stare out the window at the Earth, which is just incredibly beautiful, then sometimes we stay up late and we'll go to the windows and look out the window. Well, somebody is going to, when you pull the shield off to look outside, to look at the Earth, that would throw that light in there. So anybody on the flight deck where I was would have to wear a sleep mask if they didn't want to be disturbed by that light. But the captain owns the flight deck, so that was they just had to put up with that. Anyway, I hope that answered your question. The ship knows where it is, and we know where it is, and that daylight, day and night cycle causes problems when it's time to sleep. The rest of the time, we just work. Every 45 minutes, you're going to at least turn on the lights, and then 45 minutes later, you're going to turn them off because you're back in the daylight again. It just keeps you busy.
When you, like, first come, like, home from space or whatever, does it get kind of confusing? It's like, oh, wait, it's, like, still day?
No, I don't think we ever had a problem with, maybe because we fool ourselves by putting on sleep masks during nighttime, and then we turn those lights on and off while we're in space. So that doesn't work, but you do. It's kind of related to a previous question about sleeping. You can wake up at night, and maybe it's part of the same cycle, but you wake up at night and you're on your mattress, and your brain can convince you that you're still floating in space, that you're laying there on a cloud and not feeling anything. And then you try to move and you feel as heavy as lead. You feel like you're so heavy you can't get out off the mattress. And other folks have said that these are stories we tell amongst ourselves. They'll get up to reach for something and they'll think they can float over there still. And so they kind of roll off the bed and give themselves a little push. And of course they crash right to the floor and they're reminded that they're back on Earth.
Next up is Aiden Ledbetter. And Colonel Wilcutt, we call Aiden one of our frequent flyers because he's been to every camp probably since he was born. And Aiden is now a seventh grader at Massac Junior High School, which is in Metropolis, Illinois, right across the border.
What happens to tears in space whenever you cry?
It's the same thing as any liquid. They just form a bubble right where they form. So they don't run down your face because there's no gravity. So they just stay there. And depending on how much you cry, they would just continue to get bigger and bigger. Now you could shake your head and get them off, but water, it's just like any water that you put on your face. The reason we don't have a shower up there is because that water would float and get into electronic equipment, and whatever it sticks to, it usually doesn't bounce off. Now, if you really propel it, it'll hit, and some of the particles will bounce off. But it just stays wherever it lands. That's why the do you remember when we almost drowned an astronaut 2 or 3 years ago? I think it was. That was actually, it's been longer than that. We had an astronaut that was outside doing a spacewalk, and in our spacewalks, we have a bag of water for them, you know, with a straw that comes up toward his mouth. But we also use water to help do cooling in the spacesuit, because when you're outside on the sun side, it's plus 200 degrees Fahrenheit. So this water, the water that is used for cooling the astronaut, leaked up the back of his helmet, and it attached to his head, you know, as it came out. And then, it just stays there. So the water kept leaking, and it grew into a bigger and bigger bubble. And the bubble stays attached to his head. It doesn't run down into the suit because, there's no gravity. So eventually that bubble grew, and it covered his eyes, it covered his ears, it covered his nose, and it was covering his mouth before we got him back inside and repressurized the airlock. You always do spacewalks as two. So he had signaled to his buddy that he had a problem, and his buddy came over and grabbed him and started pulling him back to get him inside the airlock, because he could look and see the water going. Well, that water, again, it wouldn't drain. You could drown with that little layer of water, because it was going to finish covering the rest of his mouth, and then he would have been inhaling water. So the tears would do the same thing. That's why, you know, when you put, we use squeeze bags, like drink bags, to drink water out of instead of a cup. And a cup, of course, you could turn it upside down and it wouldn't run out because its surface tension sticks to the wall, but you can't get it out. The squeeze bags, you can squeeze it to force it to go someplace. We have fun with that. You've probably seen video of astronauts squeezing water into a ball and then sticking a straw in it and drinking it out of the air. Of course, it's just floating until it touches something, and then it'll adhere to that surface, which would include your cheek if it got there. If you just Google that, when something about drowning and almost drowning an astronaut, you can find the case study for that online and read about it. It was a very close call. And then, of course, we had to fix that problem. We grounded all spacewalks until we figured out what happened there and fixed the problem. And just in case, if that ever happened again, now we put a snorkel. Since the water doesn't run down in the suit, we put a snorkel that goes from the mouth all the way to the bottom of the suit, so that if water ever did cover up one, he could use that snorkel to breathe air from the bottom of the suit. That was our fix, just in case kind of fix, if it ever did happen again.
Next up, we've got Grant Seaton. He's fifth grader at Clark Elementary.
What was the most interesting thing that you saw while in space?
Two things, I guess, would be one. Two things to answer your question. By the way, Grant, I love that photo and over your shoulder there, the Death Star in the back. One of those, and this, it's not, you know, it's something that just means something to me, and I think most people, is that, you know, the Russians have always been our foes since sometime after World War II, when they became communists. Well, on my missions, I worked with the Russians. So here were Russian fighter pilots that were crewmates of mine, and we get along beautifully. I went to live in Russia to help do NASA business in Russia for 7 months. Well, here are these people that I've been trained in the Marine Corps to try to, that they were our enemies, you know, and yet here I was living in Russia, working with people that were just like me. And it's amazing when you think about being in space, you know, 200 miles away from Earth in space, and you're up there with some of your good friends, and those friends include Russians and Japanese and Canadians and Frenchmen. You know, there's all these nations around the world are working together for really to do something good for the planet and the people on Earth. That was absolutely amazing to me. Those people are still my friends. And, you know, I care about them. I care about their families. It was an amazing experience. So that was one. The second thing is looking out the window. I was shocked, and I had heard that this would be the case. The Earth was so beautiful. It was just stunning, just absolutely stunning. And you know, the atmosphere, you can see the different bands in the atmosphere when you look out the window at the curvature of the Earth. And that atmosphere is thinner, proportionally speaking, than the shellac on a pool ball, a billiard ball. That's how thin that atmosphere is. And you're overcome with a sense of how precious the planet is and how you need to take care of it. We should all be doing a better job of taking care of the Earth. Those were the two things that were most amazing to me. The beauty of the Earth. Let me tell you what happens when you launch into space. So you launch into space, it takes 8.5 minutes to get there. This is in the shuttle, but the 8.5 minutes is consistent with almost every spacecraft because it takes that long to accelerate to 5 miles a second. So you get this, you're under all this thrust, you're being massed back in your seat. And then finally the main engine is cut off and instantly you're in zero gravity and you're trying to float out of your seat. And anything that wasn't loose around you starts floating. And you hear your crew members start laughing about it because they're trying to float out their seats. And then you hear silence. You hear absolute silence. Then you hear somebody say, oh my, or wow. And that's when they have looked up and looked out the window. And that's the first time they've seen the Earth from space. It's the same thing every time you look up, you see the Earth and you go, wow, that is just so beautiful. It's gorgeous. Anyway, those were the two things I think that most shocked me or amazed me.
What does NASA do to help global warming?
Most of the sensors, many of the sensors that tell us whether the oceans are warming, whether the atmosphere is warming, the planet's warming, the oceans are warming, the sea level is rising, those are our sensors that tell us that. Where the pollution comes from, things, people that are, we all sign treaties that says, that say we won't dump any more carbon into the atmosphere than this. The satellites that measure, they determine where the carbon is coming from and how much they're putting into the atmosphere. That's our work. So we help by being the people that have the sensors and the equipment to measure and determine where it all comes from. And then you expect outfits like the United Nations, you know, where the countries have agreed to cooperate together through the United Nations, we use that to call them the task if they're not doing what they said they were going to do.
We are on our very last question, and it's our little astronaut Jonah, who was 5 years old, and he's been very patient. He is in pre-K at St. Mary Elementary School. And so, Jonah and Mom, are you ready to ask your question?
Yeah, so he loves the TV series Lost in Space. So he has a question for you.
Have you been lost in space?
I've never been actually lost in space, but I've had a few problems. Most missions do. I've only had one that I would consider a serious problem. And that was when a shuttle docked with the Mir, the Russian space station. Say, this is the shuttle and this is the Russian space station. Well, they dock and they join together. And then you have to maintain your attitude control. You have to always point your solar rays at the sun when it's there. And we usually let the shuttle do that with these little bitty jets that we fire. They're called vernier jets, but you can think of them as little position-keeping jets. So we're docked, and my space shuttle is maintaining attitude control. And in the middle of the night, I mean, it's like on Earth time, it would be like 3 o'clock in the morning, an alarm sounds on the shuttle and wakes me up. And I look and we've lost our vernier jets. We've lost our position jets. That means the whole stack is going to start tumbling. So it starts tumbling. And once the solar rays are pointed away from the sun, then you could lose all the power to the Russian space station. So I had to float over to the Russian spacecraft and wake up the Russian commander. The alarm hadn't even woke him up. He was sleeping just in free space. He didn't want to be constrained in a sleeping bag against the wall or the ceiling. He was just floating while he slept. So I had to wake him up and tell him that we had lost attitude control. And the Russian commander and I got out our procedures. And fortunately, I spoke a little Russian. He spoke a little English. And between the two of us and our procedures, we figured out how to transfer control to the Russian space station until we could fix our problem on the shuttle. So that was the biggest problem that I ever had, but we handled it because we had practiced how to turn over attitude control before the ground, you know, mission control. They run us through all these simulations where they practice every emergency that they can possibly come up with. And fortunately, that was one of them. And really, I'm glad that Yuri spoke a little English because my I did not speak enough to pull that off by myself. And just like mission control, you know, we all had to take Russian language. And the Russian Space Agency made all their cosmonauts take English language, English speaking. So between us, we always pulled it off like a good team would.
Colonel Wilcutt, I heard some new things from you. That was very exciting today. And if you've ever been to the Challenger Center, you know that we have a spacecraft and mission control, and we throw emergencies at them too that they have to solve. So I see Grant nodding their head and Emily. Yeah, so they know those things. They've had good practice at that. Nathan Franklin, you had raised your hand. Was that an accident or did you have something?
You were talking about the astronaut who had almost drowned. There was another astronaut who got some of the anti-fog from his visor into his eye, and he went blind in space because of the surface tension, and his he was crying, and he was completely blinded in space, but they got it fixed. It was okay.
He's a friend of mine. As he talked, that was terrible. That soap, like a diver, they put soapy stuff on the inside of the visor, and some of it had managed to get in his eye. And so it burned the entire time he was out there. It was terrible. The tears couldn't wash it away. It was awful. We had another one who had his boots. They look almost the same, and they slipped on his boots to go out and do an EVA, and they were backwards, and he didn't notice it. You know, at first you put up with a little bit of pressure, but by the time he had those boots on for a while, it felt like somebody was taking a vise and squeezing his foot, and he still had like 5 hours to go on his spacewalk to do a very important task. So he just had to put up with that. He couldn't get to his feet. He couldn't take his boots off. He had to abort the spacewalk to fix that problem. He just put up with it. Guys, they're just really, really disciplined when they and determined to finish their job.
Colonel Wilcutt, did you have any parting words?
Take math, science, technology courses. They lead to the most interesting jobs in the world. And those were fantastic questions. You're thinking about what goes on in space and how to live and operate up there. And that's a very good sign. And don't forget the most important thing, if you ever want to be an astronaut, is turn in that application. And you don't have to be an astronaut to work at NASA. We have brilliant engineers, brilliant scientists. They love their jobs as much as I love mine. And I would encourage you, no matter what field you choose, if you want to work there, and it's the best agency to work for in the federal government, every year, really, they do surveys to find that out, and it's the best place to work. It's a great place, a great mission. So make sure you turn in those applications when you get older. Get ready to do it. Melissa, that's it. Thank you. I enjoyed it.
Thank you. Everybody, wave goodbye to Colonel Wilcutt. Thank you so much. We appreciate you taking your time. And everybody, we hope to see you in the center soon. And you can come fly some missions with us. And remember what Colonel Wilcutt taught you.